Good evening, everyone. I am Dr. P. Vijay Kumar, lecturer, School of Agriculture, Indira Gandhi National Open University. Today, I will be discussing. I will be taking two sessions. One will be on milch breeds and the management of the dairy animals, and the second session will be on clean milk production. In this session, I will be discussing about course one, that is milk production and quality of milk. This is the course one of the Diploma in Dairy Technology. As in the last session, Professor Saluja might have discussed about the various courses in Diploma in Dairy Technology. He gave an overview about the Diploma in Dairy Technology program, which is on offer. This course one is about milk production and quality of milk. So I'll be in this session I'll be discussing block two of the course one, that is milk production, which consists of four units, out of which unit 4 milch breeds and unit 5 animal husbandry practices and healthcare will be taken in this session. And the next session will be on clean milk production. So coming to unit 4 about milch breeds. See, in India has a huge resource of dairy animals, out of which cattle, buffalo and goat, which are the main species of dairy in India, constitute about 404.1 million heads. So, but whereas the milk production in India stands around 100 million metric tons as of now, whereas it was estimated at 99 million metric tons during 2006-2007. This is about 15% of the world's milk production. That's India's contribution is 15% of the world's milk production. And our dairy industry is growing at a rapid pace with an annual growth rate of 4%. And dairy constitutes about 15% of the gross domestic product of our Indian agriculture. And about the crossbreeds, there are 8.2 million and the indigenous breeds constitute 27.6 million, which are in milk. And the buffaloes comes about 33 million, which are in milk. And India ranks first in milk production. As I have told, its production is, I think it might have crossed 100 million metric tons by now because of its rapid growth. And out of which 52% contribution is from buffaloes, which are the major milk producers in India. And 45%, which is slightly below the halfway mark, comes from cattle. And the other species like goat and other species constitute only 3%. According to the latest data, that is 2003 census, as you know that the livestock census, every 5 years there is a livestock census, and the last livestock census, that was the 17th livestock census carried out by the Department of Animal Husbandry and Dairying, was during 2003, and as per the report of the 2003 census, the cow's contribution to milk production is only 41%, whereas buffalo's contribution comes to 55%, and whereas the goat and other species comes to 4%. And in India, the majority are nondescript breeds. That is, there is no any characteristics of any breed. Breed is the group of animals which have a specific characteristics. So that we call it as a breed. Like if you take a Sahiwal, it has a certain characteristics which will be found throughout the country. If you find the animals, Sahiwal animals with the same characteristic, then it constitutes a breed. So whereas if you see many animals roaming around, you will find there is no set pattern of the animal's characteristic. So these animals we call it as non-descriptive breeds, which are constitute around 67% of our cattle population. The characteristic of these non-descriptive breeds is that they are low in milk production, but its disease resistance is very high. So milch breeds of, let us discuss about the milch breeds of cattle. Milch breeds of cattle, there are as per the cattle can be divided into three categories: milch breeds, dual purpose breeds and draught breeds. Milch breeds are animals which are kept only for milk production. Though their bulls are available, which are not much of use in the work purpose. So these milch breeds like Sahiwal, Red Sindhi, they are specially maintained for the milk production purposes. Whereas coming to the dual purpose breeds, these breeds can be used both for milk production as well as for work purposes. So the cows will be used for milk production and the bulls will be used for the work purpose, like plowing the field and the other purposes like pulling carts and other things. And the draught breeds are specifically maintained for the work purpose, like Kangayam or Amrit Mahal. They are the main draught breeds which are used for only work purpose, and their cows are of very poor yielding, maybe less than one liters per day. And coming to the milch breeds, their characteristics is they are high in milk production, and they have a capacious udder, and they are heavily built. Their udder is huge with a thick milk vein with a huge blood supply. So, coming to the indigenous breeds, there are 30 well-defined indigenous breeds in India. Their main characteristics, as I have earlier told, that they are low in milk production and they are better disease resistance. And this is the characteristic which the maybe the European countries or foreign countries are looking at India, and they are exporting our indigenous breeds or Indian breeds like Brahman, which they are using it for crossbreeding and improving their animals' disease resistance. So even in India, we are exported the foreign breeds like Holstein Friesian, Jersey, to increasing the milk production, as well as we are the disease resistance will be better in crossbreeds when you compare it to the exotic breeds. Exotic breeds like HF and Jersey, they are acclimatized to cold climate, so you cannot directly transfer it, export it and rear it here because our climate is not that much suitable for these species. Though Jersey is a bit accustomed to our climate, but the crosses of these are very well accustomed to our climate. The other reason for not using the exotic breeds in India is these exotic breeds are high milk producing animals, so their consumption of feed and fodder will be enormous. So that much amount of feeds and fodder is not available at our field level which can be fed. So crossbreeds, they consume a moderate amount of feed, and their yield is also much better than the indigenous breeds. So coming to our indigenous breeds, one of the important breeds is the Sahiwal. So the home tract of this Sahiwal is Montgomery district of Pakistan. So this is basically a Pakistani breed which has been reared in India also. In India it has been distributed in parts like Ferozpur, Amritsar, Gurdaspur districts. The main feature of this is that color is red colored. So the color is red and light brown, but some animals may have some white patches also. The other characteristic is the loose skin, and they have a medium sized ears. So the next is that they have a heavy dewlap. If you see that the dewlap is very heavy, the dewlap is a portion just below the neck. So if you see, it is a bit hanging, so that we call it as the dewlap. So it has a heavy dewlap as well as it has a straight hump. The horns are thick, though the picture doesn't have any horns because it's a female cow. The horns are thick and emerge laterally. And the milk production is around 1350 to 2500 kgs per lactation. So this is one of the good Indian milch breeds. The next important breed is the Red Sindhi. So this Red Sindhi is also similar in characteristic to Sahiwal, but the only the major difference is that they are a bit smaller in size than the Sahiwal. And they are also, the home tract is in Pakistan, that's Karachi and Hyderabad district of Pakistan. Then the color, the main color of this breed is the red, and some animals have shades ranging from dark to dim yellow. And there is the different, one of the major differences between Sahiwal and Red Sindhi is that their forehead is occasionally bulging, little bulging when compared to the Sahiwal. And their horns are thick at the base and it emerges laterally and curve upwards. So the other important characteristic is that they have a dewlap and sheath, they are a bit pendulous. And if you see the picture, see the neck region is the dewlap region, and the sheet is just before the udder. You see some bit hanging kind of thing is there. So these two are bit pendulous, and they have a capacious udder, as you know, because it's one of the characteristic of the dairy breeds. And their milk yield ranges from 1500 to 2200. This is as you know that the lactation period is 305 days. This is a usual period we have. So 305 days lactation, the average yield may be around 2750 to 2000 kg per lactation. And coming to the Gir. So Gir is one of the best Indian cattle breeds. And it is found in the Junagar and Bhavnagar and Amreli districts of Gujarat. So this you can just see that G4G, Gir is a native breed of Gujarat. And it's also found in Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh and Maharashtra. The color of this breed is also the red, but sometimes some patches of red and black are also seen. And the important characteristic is it's having extremely bulgy forehead. So forehead is the portion just in between the eyes and the lower portion. So it is bit bulgy. And the other thing is its ears. Ears are very large, drooping, and it has a small notch in the at the bottom. So another characteristic is its horn. Horns are thick, medium, and curved backward, upward, and forward, ending in an inward shape. So it is also having a capacious udder with well developed milk vein, and the milk yield ranges from 1200 to 2000 kg per lactation. So this is one of the important breeds of dairy breeds to be remembered. And the other breed is that Tharparkar. Tharparkar is found in the Tharparkar district of Pakistan. So it in India, as far as India is concerned, it is prevalent around the Indo-Pakistan border of Rajasthan. It ranges from this Indo-Pakistan border of Rajasthan to Ran of Kutch in Gujarat. And its color is white or light gray. And the characteristic of this breed is face and extremities are darker than the whole body. If you see the face and the foot and the tail, are darker than when compared to the whole body, and the horns are set well apart, and it's curving upward and outward, and the tail is thin and it hangs loosely with a black switch. The milk yield is a moderate milk yielder, and its yield ranges from 900 to 2150 kgs per lactation. And the last important dairy breed is Rati, and it is the name of Rati comes from the pastoral tribes of Rajasthan called the Rats. These Rats used to maintain these Rati breeds, and hence the name Rati. It is a mixture of Sahiwal, Sindhi and Tharparkar. The blood of these three breeds, because of the crossbreeding and other things, so this breed evolved from the cross mixture of this Sahiwal, Sindhi and Tharparkar. And it is concentrated mainly in the Bikaner district, and its color is brown. So brown with white patches, as you see in the picture, you can see that brown with white patches. And its horn is curves outwards, upwards, and its skin is also loose. The milk yield is all moderate, ranges from 1050 to 2000 kgs per lactation. So these are the main dairy breeds which are available in India. And next we move on to the dual purpose breeds, which are used both for milk and dot purposes. There are four important dual purpose breeds in India, namely Dioni, Haryana, Kankrej and Ongole. So let us see one by one. Dioni is the home tract is the Marathwada district of Maharashtra, and it's also prevalent in Karnataka and Andhra Pradesh. The color is white and also black with spotted. Some spots of black and white may also be seen. But the major portion of the body will be white in color. And they also have drooping ears and the forehead slightly bulging. It is considered that it's a mixture of Gir, Dangi, and local cattle. So this Dhoni is a mixture of these three breeds, and the tail switch is black and white, reaching just below fetlock. And the bullocks, as I told, it's a dual purpose breed. The bullocks are preferred for its heavy work purpose, and its milk yield ranges from 650 to 1250 kg per lactation. The next important dual purpose breed is Haryana. As the name indicates, its home tract is in Haryana, that is the Rohtak, Sonipat and Gurgaon districts of Haryana. And the color is ranges from white or light gray. They have a flat forehead, well marked bony prominence at the top of the pole. Pole is the region just between the two horns. That is the topmost portion of this skull. As you see, it's little bit bulgy. This is one of the important characteristics of this Haryana breed, and it's has a small and stumpy horns only. They don't have a large horns like Conkerage or some other breed. They have only short and stumpy horns, and their tail is very short, thin and tapering with black switch. Their milk yield ranges from with an average of 1500 kg per lactation. And the next breed is Conkerage. This is one of the heaviest breeds in India. Their home tract is Ran of Kutch and Jodhpur in Rajasthan. Ran of Kutch is in Gujarat and Jodhpur is in Rajasthan. So their color is silver gray to iony gray or steel black in color. Their forehead, hindquarters and humps are slightly darker. In this picture you can see that their forehead means that fierce portion, it's a bit dark, as well as the hind portion, it's darker. And it has characteristic horn. It's large, strong, curve outward and upward. It's kind of a lyre. Lyre means you know that it's a kind of a knife which the you can see that lyre shaped horns. If you see the horns, you can very well understand what is lyre. And its milk yield ranges from 1100 to 3200 kg per lactation. So this is one of the important dual purpose breeds of India. The next is Ongole. Ongole is the native breed of Andhra Pradesh, and it is found in the Ongole district of Andhra Pradesh. Its color is glossy white, and they are heavy and large animals, and their males are used for their draught purposes. And they have long limbs and a majestic gait, and their horns are short and stumpy, and their milk yield ranges from 475 to 1000 kg per lactation. These are all these dual purpose breed cows are moderate yielders, and their males are used for this draught purpose. Coming to the exotic breeds, the two important exotic breeds which have been exported to India, imported to India from the abroad countries, is the Holstein Friesian and the Jersey. The other breeds are the Brown Swiss and Red Dane. These two has also been tried for crossbreeding purposes, but these Holstein Friesian and Jersey are more suitable to our condition. And whereas the Kerala government tried this Brown Swiss, and they found that there is a difficulty in giving birth because this Brown Swiss is a huge animal, and the calf, our indigenous animals cannot hold the size of the calves. So there was a lot of reproductive problems. So Brown Swiss was not much used in India, and similar is the case in Red Dane also. So the Holstein Friesian is having a typical color as you see in the picture. It's having a black and white markings. This Holstein Friesian is from the Friesland in Netherlands. So they are very high yielders, and their high milk production is very high, and whereas the only disadvantage is their fat percentage is bit low. It ranges from 3 to 3.5. But the Jersey is more suited to our Indian climatic condition, and it is from the island of Jersey, that is situated between the France and the England. So this the color is reddish brown, as you see in the picture. It's reddish brown in color. The main difference between the indigenous exotic breeds, you can see there is no hump in the exotic breeds. So that is one of the important characteristic, as well as there is no dewlap, not much dewlap, and sheath are not much developed in exotic breeds. So if you can see the maybe the animal and identify whether it's having the blood of Indian breed or exotic breed by looking into these two main characteristics. That is the hump. Hump is the neck portion which is bulging in case of the Indian breeds, whereas it is not there in the exotic breeds. So its milk yield is also very high. It ranges from 5000 to 8000 per lactation, and its fat percentage is somewhat equal to our Indian breeds, which is around 5%. So in India, mostly these two breeds are used for crossbreeding purposes because they are well suited for our Indian condition. And the next one is the brown cis. It is called the triple purpose breed. So it can be used for milk production, drought purpose, as well as some foreign countries, Switzerland, they use for meat purpose also. So it is called triple purpose breed, and it is the origin is from Switzerland. They are very docile and easily manageable animals, and their color ranges from light to dark brown. Their milk yield ranges from 6000 to 8000 kgs per lactation. And the last one is the Red Dane. They are originated from Denmark, and their color is red to reddish brown or dark brown. So coming to the synthetic breed, means the breeds which are developed by crossbreeding different means animals. That synthetic means they are not the naturally developed breeds, cattle breeds. They are developed by intervention of humans. So in NDRI Karnal, that's National Dairy Research Institute Karnal, they have taken up they had taken up a project, and they have developed a breed called Karan Swiss. It's a mixture of brown Swiss bull with the Sahiwal and Red Sindhi cow. And another trial was conducted with the Holstein Friesian bull and Tharparkar cow, which resulted in Karan Swiss. All these synthetic breeds have good better milk yielding capacity than the Indian breeds, and they have a good disease resistance capacity also. So the other trial was made in the military dairy farm in Meerut, and they developed a breed called Frieswal, and it is a cross between Holstein Friesian bull and the Sahiwal cows. And in Kerala, the Livestock Development Board Kerala, they have developed a breed, synthetic breed called Sonandini. It's a cross between, as I told, they use brown Swiss for crossing. They have developed this breed by crossing brown Swiss bulls with the non-descriptive local or Sahiwal or Red Sindhi. Coming to the breed improvement, see how you can improve the breed of the cattle. You can improve by three ways. One is selective breeding, other is grading up, and third one is crossbreeding. I'll take up one by one. What is selective breeding? Selective breeding is crossing of best males with best females. So you can raise a question, what is best male and what is best female? So if you have a farm, you select the male which is having better milk production capacity than the average of the group. If you take 100 animals, you select an animal select a female whose milk yield is higher than the average of these 100 animals. So that is the best female. And while selecting the males, you can select the males whose mothers, that is, we call it as dam, whose dam's average and the father side's grand dam's average production, as well as the daughter's production. If you compare this, it should have a good capacity than the average. So the males also plays 50% role in the transfer of this genetic, that is characteristic, to their daughters. So if the male is of very poor quality and the mother is of good milk yielder, then also it will not work, because 50% of the milk production capacity characteristic carried from the father. So the selective breeding is one of the important technique to improve the milk production capacity. The next is the grading up. Grading up, what is called grading up? Grade up. As the name indicates, you are improving the grade of the animals, that is their production capacity. So this is mainly used for our indigenous breeds, because these indigenous breeds constitute 67%, that is 2/3 of our cattle population. So these indigenous breeds can be upgraded using this Indian breeds. See, selective breeding is you are taking a best breed from a group of animals, whereas grading up is you are using the Indian breeds like Sahiwal, Red Sindhi, Thar Parker for improving the milk production capacity of the indigenous or non-descriptive breeds. They are of no character. So this grading up is very much suitable in the regions where there is a feed and fodder scarcity, because these Indian breeds like Sahiwal, Sindhi doesn't consume much of the fodder when compared to the exotic breeds. So this can be used for grading, this grading up can be used in the regions where there is feed and fodder scarcity. Whereas crossbreeding, you can take it up in irrigated, well irrigated and good fodder production areas and feed areas where the availability of feed and fodder is good. So this crossbreeding is the crossbreeding. It's a cross between two breeds, as the name indicates. So you are crossing our Indian breeds like Sahiwal, Sindhi with the exotic breeds like HF and Jersey. So this crossbreeding program is taken up in India since 7-8 decades, and it has yielded a very good, all our milk production, increase in the milk production capabilities of India is because of this. One of the reason is the crossbreeding, the program taken up by our Indian government. And this initially we cross it the Indian breeds with the exotic breeds, and subsequent crossing will be with the cross breeds, because if you cross the keep on crossing with the exotic breeds, the blood level of the progenies will be towards the exotic breeds. So subsequent crossing should be through crossbred bulls only. Now coming to the milch breeds of buffaloes, I'll just go through the breeds. There are 7 important breeds like Murrah, Bhadavari, Jafarabadi, Surti, Mehsana, Nagpuri, Neeli Ravi. So Murrah is the breeding tract is in Punjab, and the horns are slight, short and tightly curved, and its tail is long, it's reaching the fetlock, and its color is jet black. You see the picture, it's jet black. And the milk yield is around 1500 to 2000 kgs per lactation, and their milk fat is around 7%. So coming to the next breed is Bhadavari, and its breeding tract is in Madhya Pradesh, that's Agra and Etawah district. It has having a wedge shaped body. If you see from its head, wedge means it's a triangle shape. So if you see from the top, from the head to the back portion, you can see a triangle type. So it's having a typical wedge shaped body, and its tail is long, thin, and black and white markings. You can see the picture. And it's having a light or copper colored body, and its milk yield is also moderate, 800 to 1000 kgs per lactation. This is one of the important characteristics is it's having a very high milk fat percentage. Usually the buffaloes have a very high milk fat percentage when compared to the cattle. But Bhadavari, within buffaloes, this is one of the breeds which is having a very high milk fat percentage, which ranges from 6.5 to 12.5. The other important breed is the Surti, which is also having high milk fat percentage. Coming to the third breed, that is Jafarabadi, and it is found in the Gujarat, and it is one of the heaviest breeds of buffaloes. And it is having a typical horn. If you see in the picture, you can see the typical horn. It's very heavy, and it droop on the sides close to the neck, and turning up at the points. So if you now you can easily identify which the breed Jafarabadi by looking at the animals. And the important color, it's having a black color, and its milk yield is 1400 to 2300 kg per lactation. The next breed is the Surti. Its breeding tract is in Khaira and Vadodara districts of Gujarat, and it's having a wedge shaped body, and you can see the color ranges from brown, black or brown. And the important characteristic of this breed is that they are having two white bands, one around the jaw and one around the brisket. Brisket is again the portion just below the neck. So it's having this characteristic, and its milk fat is also very high. And the next breed is Mehsana. It is considered to be a cross between the Surti and Murrah, and its also color is from black to grey with white marking on face, legs and tail tips. And the next breed is the Nagpuri. Its breeding tract, as you see, it's from Nagpur of Maharashtra, and it is also having a characteristic horn. If you see, it's a long curving backwards, and it reaches around the neck. And its milk production is not that high. And the last breed, important breed, is the Neeli Ravi, and it is origin from Pakistan. It's Ferozpur and Amritsar district of Punjab and Pakistan. And the important characteristic is its wall eyes, and it's having a black color with white markings on the head and in its legs. And it's also a good milk yielder. And coming to the breed improvement. So again, in buffaloes, the improvement cannot be crossbreeds because there is no exotic breed of buffalo. I mean to say, most of the breeds are around India and Pakistan. So there is no exotic breed as such in buffaloes. So the main improvement is through selective breeding. As I told, young males and female calves should be selected based on their growth, reproductive and productive performances. And the next is the grading up through the genetically superior progeny tested bulls. The milk breeds of goat. The goat is considered to be the poor man's cow, and it's highly adaptable to varying environmental conditions, and it is survive in sparse vegetation. So the indigenous goat breeds like Jamunapari, Beetle, Zalawadi, Jakarana and Surti, they are the main indigenous goat breeds which are used for milk production. That's dairy purpose. One of the important is Jamunapari. It's from Etawah district of Uttar Pradesh, and its color is white with some kind of tan. That is tan, we call it as brown color. And it's a dual purpose breed which is used for both milk and meat production. And the other important breed is Beetle, and its color is black with it has a bird. And Surti is also one of the important breeds. It's from Gujarat, and its color is predominantly white. So the exotic dairy, there are few exotic dairy breeds which are used for dairy purposes in foreign countries. These breeds are not prevalent in India though, like Alpine, Shannon, Toggenburg and Anglo-Nubian. So this Anglo-Nubian is a used for cross Jamunapari. Our Jamunapari Indian breed is used for crossing with the Nubian breed of the Egypt, and they evolved this Anglo-Nubian. And breed improvement, again, it's through selective breeding and crossbreeding. Though crossbreeding doesn't give much desired result as expected. So coming to the animal husbandry practices and healthcare, this is unit number 5, and in this mainly we'll go through the topics which I have listed there, is like management of down covers, calf raising, heifer management, breeding management, management of milking cows, management of dry animals, healthcare practices. So I'll just go through these topics. Like in management of down covers and calf raising, the topics covered like down covers, care and management of down covers, care and management of calf after birth. So these are sequence of events. Like you first manage the cow which is going to give birth, and then management of calf and the management of growing calves. First is the down covers. Down covers are the animals which are expected to deliver shortly. So these down covers are pregnant cows. What in colloquial terms we call it as pregnant cows. They should be shifted from the normal group of animals, because in advanced stage the animals there is a tendency that animals usually play and fight. So there should not be any injury to these pregnant cows. So these pregnant cows should be transferred to a separate shed. If you have a separate shed, it should be transferred to a separate shed. Usually call it as calving pen. So only one animal is kept in this pen. So the animal should be shifted to these calving pens 1 to 2 weeks prior to the expected date of calving. And these down covers require a special care and management, because giving birth is as you know, it's a difficult phenomena, and it requires special care and management. And there should be adequate bedding, and the diet should be laxative, and it should be divided in different doses. Like if you provide, just we like we provide to our young ones, we divide the diet into different portions and give it in intervals. So it will be easy for them to digest. And we should also provide clean drinking water, and it should be protected from extreme climates like heat and winter. So these are all stress which may affect the pregnancy. So next, after giving birth to the what are the signs of calving? Let us see. So the signs of calving are like the udder becomes swells, because immediately after calving the animal has to give milk to the calf. So udder, there is a growth in the udders, and the udder becomes swollen, and there is a ligament. That ligament usually just between the tail, in the hip portion, the ligament, it becomes loose, because this ligament, only if it loosens, then it will be the easy for the animal to deliver the calf. So this ligament becomes loosened and the udder swells, and the calving it takes from 2 to 4 hours depending upon the animal. And the one of the important things to be noted immediately after calving is that expulsion of placenta. Placenta is the membrane which connects the calves to the mother. So for transfer of the feed, this nutrients to the calves. So this we call it as placenta. This placenta should be expelled within 8 to 12 hours. If some problem is there in the expulsion of this placenta, then you should call the veterinary doctor for removing this placenta. Because if you leave this placenta inside the animal itself, then it may act as a source for spreading of infection to the uterus. So now we come to the care and management of the calves. Calves, see, immediately after birth, calves should be taken care of very well, because they are more prone for diseases and other external influences. So the how you should attend the newly born calf. These newly born calves, when it comes out of the womb, so their face will be covered with membranes and liquids, which is because it's inside the uterus, so it's full of membranes and liquids. So this will be covered with face, nostrils may be covered with these membranes. So this should be removed in order to facilitate respiration, and adequate bedding should be given. The navel cord, which I told is the cord which connects the membrane, like from placenta it will be connected. So this navel cord, even in humans, you can see that navel cord, the connection between the mother and the young one. So this navel cord should be cleaned, and it should be cut, and disinfectant should be applied. This helps in preventing the entry of microorganism, bacteria and other through these membranes. So this is one of the important management of the calves, is the disinfection of the navel cord. Another equally important management practice is colostrum feeding, because immediately after the young one comes from the outside the mother, it requires some nutrients, because if during its present inside, the nutrients come from the mother. After it comes outside, it should be fed colostrum. Colostrum is the milk which is available for the first 3 to 5 days. It is highly rich in antibodies, that is immune antibodies, and it's also rich in nutrients, proteins, energy source, and it's a rich source of nutrients as well as the immunoglobulins. So it should be provided within 30 minutes from birth at the rate of 1/10 of its body weight. If you take 25 kg calf, the animal should be provided 2.5 kg of colostrum. This also should be provided in split doses. Should not provide this colostrum at a time to the calf. And so the next, coming to the growing calves. So the growing calves also require adequate nutrients for its growth. So the important management practice is that they should be provided individual housing for 4 to 6 weeks. So this is a growing period and it requires adequate care. So up to 4 to 6 weeks, it should be kept in separate house, individual house. And again, it should be protected from cold and heat, and can go for tattooing or dehorning as per the requirements. And the weaning is the separation of the young one from the mother. So if you wean immediately after birth, it will reduce the cost of labor, because the calves would be taken care of by the laborers. Next, coming to the feeding of growing calves, milk feeding up to five days. Colostrum feeding up to 5 days. From 5 days to 3 months, milk should be fed. Again, at the rate of 1/10 to 1/15 of its body weight. Then you can slowly introduce concentrate. Concentrate is a mixture of cereals and other things, as you know, concentrate. This concentrate you can start slowly feeding. You should not provide more concentrate in the beginning. Slowly it should be introduced at 1 month. Similarly, fodder can be introduced at 15 days and slowly it should be increased. And deworming should be done regularly. Coming to heifer management. What is heifer? Heifer is the female young ones, that is, female animals from 1 year of age to the till calving. So heifers are the replacement for the present dairy animals. So at least 20 to 25% replacement rate should be there. So 20 to 25% of the herd should be the heifers. And its feeding and nutrition is also important, because the development of these reproductive organs and their overall the health of the animal depends upon the feed and nutrition. So the animal should be fed adequately and given good care. They should be kept in loose houses, and they should be protected from the harsh weather climates, endo and ectoparasites. And coming to the breeding management. Breeding management go for sexual maturity and onset of estrus cycle. Puberty is the phase where the animal is sexually mature, but we cannot say it's sexually mature, but we cannot go for breeding. The actual sexual maturity is the age where it's able to reproduce. So the estrus cycle is the heat period which comes regularly. So every 21 or plus or minus 3 days you can take it is the estrus cycle. So the estrus cycle is a regular cycle, and it should be repeated every 21 to 24 days. If there is difference in the duration, then there is some problem in this. So the animal comes to heat, and the mature ovum, that is the egg, is released during this estrus cycle. And this heat detection, how you detect the heat for inseminating. So the length of the estrus cycle, as I told, is 8 to 24 hours. This is length of the estrus cycle, the period in which the animal is in heat. So the symptoms are like, early symptoms are like the swelling is there in the vulva, and they attempt to mount, and there is billowing and other things. And whereas the correct period of insemination is after 6 to 8 hours, that is the correct period of insemination is standing heat, that is the animal will stand to be mounted. The other animals mount on this animal, the animal, if it stands still, then it is called standing heat. And the heat detection can be done by teaser bulls also, or through a physical examination, and it should be done regularly. And artificial insemination is a method by which the semen is injected into the animal female reproductive tract. And coming to the management and feeding of milking cows. Milking cow management is also an important practice, and the animal should be kept in loose house, and it should be protected from harsh climate. And feeding is 2.5 to 3.5% of its body weight. And the concentrate for every 2.5 kg of milk produced, 1 kg concentrate, and every for cattle, and every 2 kg, 1 kg of concentrate for buffaloes. So even the health management is also important feature, because there are many diseases like FMD, HS, and the vaccination should be done for these diseases. To have a healthy stock, the animals should be kept in a good condition. Their feeding, management and health care should be adequate to increase the profitability of our dairy farming.